can go to school. Before I can eat. Before I can sleep. Before I can wake. How do I know I'm going to live long? And the mother and father went, oh, congratulations. He looked at them again, he cried. And the mother said, maybe you need to eat. Let me give him some food to eat.
They come here to Chokuria.
And they remove his mouth. Because the trouble is too much. And as soon as the child begins to grow up, to bring out the teeth is a trouble. To begin to crawl is a trouble. When he begins to walk, he falls many times and stand up. He hurt himself and stand up. So the trouble starts. The problem starts. Sometimes there will be food. Sometimes there will not be food. Sometimes there will be joy. Sometimes there will not be joy. The time of joy is not much. But the time of trouble is too much. Those are the things that the babies saw when they were crying. Every one of us saw it when we were born. But when we begin to grow, we forget it. When we begin to grow, we forget it. So I am establishing to you the fact that this world is a place of battle. You are all fighting it before you came to Christ. So don't be among the people that say, oh, it is when I got born again that I have trouble in my life. It is not when I'm born again I have issues to challenges and trouble. You have been fighting battle before you got born again. But when you got born again, it's another different battle. Battle is not straight to anybody in life. People that are not born again, they are battling with one issue or the other. There are people that are not born again, they are battling with the issue of childlessness. They don't have babies.
No.
They are not born again, but they don't have children. But when you see a Christian, they are born again, they don't have children. They say, oh God, what are you doing to my life? That is not where I'm going today. I told you I don't want to say much thing for now. I want to reserve it for after lunch. I will tell you more about the battle when we come back. But I want to tell you revelation quickly. God has brought some of you into the city and into good places. They used to love God. But as soon as God brought them out, their love for God died. And even there are some of you that are still here, your love for God cannot be defined. All of you say, I love God. You even sing. I can see some of our sisters sang here a few minutes ago. You say, oh, we love Jesus. Jesus, we love you. But the truth is, your love is not enough for him. The way you have defined love is not in singing to God. The way you define love is not when things are going right for you. The way you define love is not just being alone in this place. But the way you define love is according to what Apostle Paul wrote in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If you can have that kind of love for God, the Bible told us that the love is the completeness of the law of the commandment. If you can love God, how do you love God with all your mind? That is the first message that he wants me to tell you as I get here. That's why I'm saying this now. Including pastors, we pastors. Majority of people don't know what the love of God is. We believe love of God is when I come to church, when I've seen. Like I travel from many kilometers, I come to Kabuyandi, I said, I love God. That is not love of God. Love of God is determined when you are passing through troubles of life. The love of God is testifying in your life when you are passing through challenges and troubles. When you are challenged and you are smiling and you can still lift your hand to wait to worship the Lord. Love sovereign long. Love sovereign long. Endures. Praying for something and it's not coming. Are you patient? So the first thing God wants me to tell you before I come back in the afternoon to tell you the second message is you must define your love for Him.
Because
the Lord is not interested in everything you want to be. Because I'm not saying that He does not love you, He does not want you to be happy. But God is interested in you making heaven. He wants you to make heaven. I'm saying now, I'm just speaking in parables now. I have not really gone into what I want to talk about.
But
when we come back, I will rest a little bit and you will rest also. I will rest and you will rest. Then we'll come back to deal with the situation. And I want to tell you the Lord will set so many people free to you here today. In the mighty name of Jesus of Nazareth. So the Lord wants you to love Him. Because it shows that many people here under my voice today, you are going in and out of sin. Today you are up early. Tomorrow you are down insane. Today you are up. Tomorrow you are insane. The more you want to go up, the more you see yourself going down. And this is according to your own voluntary will. He is there to help you out of sin. He is there to make you live a life that He wants you to live. But you voluntarily go into the sin yourself. In that revelation, I will liken it to another proverb. How many people know what a pig is? A pig. There was a king. There was this king. He was going on, he visited a rural area one day. And he saw a pig. And this pig has children, babies around him. And the babies were very dirty, and the mother, everybody, you know, pig used to be dirty. And they were eating from the dung hill, the rubbish. And the king stopped. And the king looked at them. He called one of his entourage. He said, Can you find who is the owner of this pig? And the owner came forth. And he said, can you tell them to sell me one of these pig babies? I like to rear it to take it to the palace. Then they say, you are the king. Any amount you want to pay. So the king offered the money and paid for the pig. He took this pig home. But he told his staff, his stewards. He told his stewards, the servant.
He told his
servant to go and wash the pig, clean very well, put cream on the body, and even sew clothes for the pig. So they decorated the pig to make it look like a royalty. So, and the king said, whenever I eat on my dining table, Make sure this pig is sitting down on the table. So we share the food together. I don't want him to be hitting from the rubbish and the bin. I don't want him to be dirty anymore. So the pig was in the palace for many years. After many years, the king visited the same area again, the dung hill, the rubbish area, the village. So the king went with the pig. With all his entourage. And as they were going, the pig too was going with them. And all of a sudden, the pig saw the rubbish. He saw the dung hill. And he saw the mud. Then he remembered where he came from. Then he jumped out of the entourage. And he jumped into the mud. I wash and I cleanse you. I brought you to the palace to eat with me. For many years you have learned how to eat good food. For many years we dress and clothe you like human beings. For many years you had your room in my palace. Just one day outing.
Just to
look at what you have done to yourself. You rubbish everything that I put upon you. You rubbish my glory. You put to shame my glory. You stain the garment that placed upon you. With dirt and rubbish. Since this is the way you choose to live your life, there's no way I can help you any further. I have to go now. So you go and stay where you belong. So what am I telling you today? This is the message that the Lord wants me to tell people of Kabianda. A lot of times the Lord paid the penalty of your sin. He paid for you to be saved. He was not a sinner. But he became sinner for your sake. He took all your guilt and pain.
Yeah.
And he took you into his palace. He cleansed you and he clothed you with a garment of glory. And he brought you into the palace. You that you want nothing. And he make you expensive by the precious blood of the Lamb. And you seated in the heavenly places with him, far above all principalities and powers. And you became one of the people that speak in the heavenly realm. And all of a sudden, just one day, the Lord is calling you back home today. If your mind is not changed, your body cannot be changed. Because the pig body was changed, but the pig mind was not changed. So his body still believe where he came from. I mean, his mind still believe that he came from the dust. But if the mind was changed, he would know that he has been transformed. That is where I brought you into the Bible before we close on this section. Romans chapter 8. Romans 8 from verse 1. Can somebody read it in your language, please? Romans 8:1. Romans 8:1-2. Do you want to read it, sir? Yeah. I read the English. He said, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of the Lord, present your body as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Amen.
To tell you, the Lord wants me to tell you that many people in this end time, they are born again with mouth. Not from their mind. The salvation does not begin from their mind. They don't even understand what they are doing. But because there is a program like this, and somebody was preaching about blessing or healing, and he said, if you want to be part of this healing, can you give your life to Jesus? And somebody said, I want to give my life to Jesus. And they said, Lord Jesus, I give my life to you today. Everything coming from the mouth. But they don't really understand it. You will never be free from sin. You will always struggle with sin. If you understand what salvation is, you took your time to get into it deeply, and you see the purpose of salvation, and you know the reason why Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, and you realize the pain that he went through, the nails on the two hands, the crown of thorn on his head, the nail on his leg, the sword that was pierced on his side, the blood that gushed out of him, the water that came out of him, the purpose of salvation, to reconcile men back to God. You were not saved that you can get money. You were not saved that you can get healing. You were not saved that you can be delivered. You were saved to go to heaven. That is why we call it salvation. That is why we call it salvation. Salvation is liberty from death to life. If you have not been saved from death unto life, if you have not been removed from death unto life, you are not saved yet. So if I confess God in my mouth, and I tell everybody that I give my life to Jesus, and I still live in secret sin, I am not saved yet. Because that is not the definition of salvation. Let me quickly tell you before I go now, the meaning of sin. I know I'm running late, I'm sorry. Can I continue? For 5 to 10 minutes. Clap for Jesus if you want me to continue. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. What is the meaning of salvation? I believe you have some rivers around here. Some rivers.
Okay.
If somebody fall into river, and he does not know how to swim, and he was drowning, and somebody that knows how to swim jump into the river and pick the person and bring him out, is he saved or not? That is salvation. But when he is in the water, and this person that wants to take him say, come with me, let's go. I am in the choir. I am a Sunday school teacher. teacher. I'm even a pastor.
Now
and I'm swimming every day in the pool of sin. And Jesus is extending his hand to you. Come on, let me save you. Come on, don't kill yourself. This is what they call salvation. Salvation is to come out of the pool of
sin.
And stand on the platform of righteousness. Stand on the platform of righteousness. That is what they call salvation. But everybody in the world today, in America, in Europe, in
Congo,
in Rwanda, in Uganda, I am saved. I live for Jesus. I'm swimming inside sin. Swimming inside lie. Adultery. Fornication. Corruption, immorality, and I speak out of their Bible. Because I confess with my mouth, I believe in my heart, I am saved. He has paid for the penalty of my sin. That is not salvation. You must be out to be saved. If you are in, you are not saved. Because that thing you are battling with can still send you to hellfire. Therefore, you are not saved. When you are out of it, on the way to heaven, that is when you are saved. When you are inside it, on the way to hellfire, you are not saved. That is the purpose of salvation. What Bible says is, and people misunderstand it, he says, with your mouth, you confess. With your heart, you believe it. But people mistake that. They don't understand what it means. What it means is, can I tell you what it means quickly before I go? Because I have another message when I come back. You see, what you confess in my mouth, the Bible says, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. Before I can speak to you, I already understood it. It's already in my heart. So belief comes first. Then confession comes again. If you are not believed, you cannot confess. But if you confess out of deception, when you are not believed yet, you will not get your salvation right. You will always commit sin. You don't belong to God yet. When I was coming into Uganda yesterday, I met some immigration. And they say, can I see your passport? I gave them my passport, and they look at my face, they look around, they look back into the passport, they said okay, and they gave it to me and said, you are welcome to Uganda. Why did they give me the passport to say I'm welcome to Uganda? Because they could just say, my friend, this is not you. He doesn't look like you. We suspect you sit down here. And we will call some more people to check this. But they did not say that. They just say, you are welcome. Why? Because they look. He look like me. Without doubt. My ears look the same. My eyes look the same. My nose look the same. My face look the same. And the immigration was convinced in her heart that this is you. Go into Uganda. But many Christians don't look like Jesus. Your face don't look like him. Your ears don't look like him. Your mouth don't look like him. It doesn't look like what you read in the Bible. Even your neighbors can tell that you are not Christian yet. Your character and your attitude does not show a child of God. And yes, you say, I live for Jesus. I am a child of God. You are not yet a child. Unless you are changed and repentant. Unless you give your life totally to him. Unless you allow yourself to be washed with his blood. Salvation is is free gift.
Jesus
died to give us free.
Yes, I can factor
it. But it is our responsibility to make it work. As free as it is, it is you that you must make it work. It is you that you must walk out of sin. It is you that you make sure that you look like Jesus. Philippians chapter 2 from verse Philippians chapter 2 from verse 12. Apostle Paul says, even as you do when I was around, even when I'm not around, you must make sure you work out your salvation with fear and trembling. So I leave you with that now. I want you to need to think about this before you come back. Am I a child of God? Am I saved yet? The message Jesus asked me to bring here, but because it's salvation that will make you be physically free also. The reason why you battle with anything you battle with, and it looks like God is not living and it does not exist, is because you have not gotten your salvation right. And when we come back, I will tell you another revelation that the God will reveal to me. Please make sure that you are here when we come back. If you want to call another person quickly at home, please send for them. The Lord will save you and he will deliver you completely from every battle of life. In the mighty name of Jesus. Shall we rise on our feet and pray? I want you to lift your hands unto the Lord. You will say like this: Lord, prepare me for the perfect deliverance that you set ahead of me. I want you to begin to say that in a few minutes. Continue to ask God that. Deliver my body, spirit, and soul from the bondage of life and the devil. Set me free during this meeting, O Lord, completely. Illuminate my life with your blood. Glorify your name in my life. In Jesus' mighty name. Father, I thank you, for this is just the beginning, oh God. I have just laid the foundation of the message unto them. And we are coming back to start from where we stop, oh Lord. Release your unction and your anointing, Father. Release your angels, oh God. Glorify your name in our midst, oh Lord. Father, we pray that you give us a perfect day in the name of Jesus. Do not permit the rain to disturb us, Father. The rain is a messenger, and we are other messenger here, Father. And a messenger cannot disturb the other, Lord. Therefore, we command that the rain will not disturb us in the name of Jesus. Your name will be established and glorified in this place, Father. Hallelujah to your name, Lord.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. Now, today I will not pray for people yet. We will still be preaching. I want to let you know what God wants first. But tomorrow I want you to bring any cases. Because wherever the name of the Lord is glorified, he will manifest his power there. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw people to myself. So tomorrow, if there is any sickness, any disease, any infirmity, any deliverance case, any kind of thing, the Lord that has sent us will be doing the healing. In the book of Acts chapter 16 in verse 20, the Bible says the disciples went preaching Jesus Christ. Mark 16:20. When preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says the law confirming his word in their mouth. The signs and wonders that follow it. We have seen that happen. In the places we preach his gospel. And that has nothing to do with me or anybody. The healing or deliverance has nothing to do with me. But it has to do with him. When we preach his gospel. And when people give their life to him. He is happy in heaven. And he releases his power into our midst. For healing, for victory, for deliverance, and for anything. And the Lord will be glorified in this place. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you.